Afin de mieux comprendre
In order to better understand metabolism in territories, we need and analyze the origin of materials which are consumed. They can be extracted locally or they can be imported. And this is illustrated through the example of Paris and of its supply in nitrogen. Food nitrogen. Food nitrogen was distributed into three major categories of products. Grain, to the left, animal products, in red, fruit and vegetables, in green.
L'observation de la première carte,
when we look at the first map, the one that shows grain, we see that the supply area for those materials is close to Paris. It's mostly the Seine river basin, although we see that there are other contributing or other countries that contribute, like Italy. As for animal products, the situation is slightly different. The supply area is further away from Paris. It's in Normandy, in the west of France, but it's also very much present in other countries like Spain, Germany, and the UK. If we compare animal products and grain, we see that these two maps are complementary. It shows that agricultural territories are specialized. Some have specialized in grain production, others in animal production, which explains for some of the environmental problems that these territories are faced with. Now, if we look at the last map for fruit and vegetable, we see that there is a supply area which is far more diverse. It's in France, close to Paris, but also elsewhere in Europe, and in Africa. So we see the extreme globalization of the Parisian food supply chain. This notion of supply area can be applied to food, and it can also be applied to all sorts of products, but it can also be related to the concept of environmental footprint. This is illustrated here through the food nitrogen balance in Paris to follow up on what we just talked about. What we see on this graph is in the center, shaded in blue, we see the nitrogen consumption of someone living in Paris per year, so that's 7.5 kilograms. So you have plant food for one third and two thirds for animal food products. Then we see solid waste and liquid waste linked to the recycling of nitrogen, of urban nitrogen, to avoid contaminating the soils and water environments. But if we look at the left of the graph, we see the total quantity of nitrogen that was needed to produce the food products that we consume in Paris. 25 kilos of nitrogen to produce 7.5, so there is a huge waste. And this waste is in plant production. When I'm talking about plant production, I'm talking about plants dedicated for human food chain, but also in animal production, because it takes a lot of nitrogen to produce meat for human beings. This animal production linked to plant production accounts for 25 kilos, and that's the nitrogen footprint of a Parisian person. And this is compensated for, it is made up of nitrogen, synthetic nitrogen, but also largely by animal feed, cattle feed, and the share of cattle feed, which is imported from other countries, and more specifically, soya from South America. What we see there is that if we consider If we take into account animal feed, we have a picture which is slightly different from what we saw previously, and it corroborates this idea of a globalization of the food system and globalization of the urban nitrogen cycle, because in Paris, nitrogen, you see the importance of nitrogen in Paris. There are two challenges we need to put forward when talking about this graph. First, the recycling of urban nitrogen. Second, our diet. We see the big challenge there would be in reducing the share of meat products in order to limit the nitrogen losses and their consequences, environmental consequences, but also social and health consequences. We should not conclude from that that cities should be sentenced. We need to see cities as a potential of resources, of innovation, and as the lever that should be mobilized for whoever would like to go towards dematerialization.